Welcome to the Small Business Report with your co-host, Carl Brown, the Executive Director of the DC Small Business Development Center, and Sharon Morton. They're bringing you all the tools you need to succeed. Stay tuned for expert advice for business owners, subject matter experts, and government agencies on how to start, grow, and finance your business right here at HUR Voices on Sirius XM, Channel 141. The Small Business Report will be right back with a show you don't want to miss after these messages.
Hey, Small Business Report listeners, are you a small or mid-sized business? Let BDPAtoday.com help you leverage emerging technologies and digital innovations to transform your business.
BDPAtoday.com will highlight your organization's innovations, solutions, and success stories. Let BDPAtoday.com publish your branded videos, blogs, and photos to a national tech industry audience and assist with your awareness building campaign. With BDPAtoday.com, you can network with qualified and certified tech professionals and get access to developers, gamers, hackers, and interns to join your team for short or long-term projects.
Visit BDPAtoday.com for true digital transformation that will drive competitive advantage to your organization.
That's BDPAtoday.com.
This is HUR Voices on Sirius XM Radio Channel 141 with your hosts Carl Brown and Sharon Wood.
Welcome to the Small Business Report here on Sirius XM Channel 141, HUR Voices. Hey, this is your host, Carl Brown, and I got my co-host with me.
Always here, Sharon Morton from MortonMediaTV.com. And Carl, this is, I think, our fifth year.
That's right.
The Small Business Report.
Number five.
Can you believe how fast time has gone by? I remember when you were just going down to the station to ask if you could tape a public service announcement?
PSA.
Right. And they gave you a whole show.
Walked out of there with a radio show.
With a radio show. Oh, my God.
Well, remember a couple weeks ago I said you got to be prepared, right?
That's right. That's
so
right.
When they said, they pivoted on me and said, right. Hey, man, instead of a PSA, how about a radio show?
And I was exactly right. And then you called me. You was like, Sharon, they gave me a whole radio show. I couldn't believe it.
A whole radio show.
Yeah.
Because what we got to say is relevant to small businesses. And we're helping build the communities around the country and really around the world. Because we got listeners from all over.
It's unbelievable. It is unbelievable.
How people are tuning in and listening and wanting to be a part of this show. So we're very blessed to have it, and we protect it at all costs. So.
We do. And I'm just glad to be a part of it. I'm glad you asked me to be a part of it. We've partnered on a number of ventures together, TV. But like you said, this is a business show with great information for small business owners, and the radio station recognized that they didn't have anything on the air at that time that does what we do, and so we were just very
happy. Well, they still don't.
And they still don't. That's right. So we're just
HUR voices, but just all over the dial. I mean, you try to hear something about small business, and you're going to hear about Google and Amazon and all these other people, but you're not going to hear about the mom and pops or like the Pam Perry's who we got on the show today.
Yeah, we have Pam Perry that need to be highlighted. Yeah, and she's an award-winning communications professional. She teaches and mentors authors, speakers, and entrepreneurs on how to build a platform and attract major media and publishing contracts. So we're happy to have her on the show. She and I have a bit of synergy. We do a little bit of the same thing. And then who do we have on the other half, Carl?
We have urban anthropologist Sabia Prince. And she's going to be talking about the impacts of the COVID virus on Black-owned businesses.
Oh, that's going to be good.
In the District of Columbia. But it could be anywhere.
I was going to say,
Harlem, it could be in Hawaii.
Anywhere.
Miami, it doesn't matter. The effects of the COVID virus have been devastating on Black businesses around the country. So we're going to be talking to Dr. Sabia Prince a little bit later.
Okay, so we've got a break for commercial, but we want you to stay tuned. We're going to have a great show today here on the Small Business Report on SiriusXM Radio Channel 141, HUR Voices.
Are you in trouble with the IRS? Whether you owe federal or state taxes, are under audit, or need to dispute your case in tax court, don't go up against the IRS alone. Let the tax experts at the law office of Beverly Winstead fight for you. With more than 15 years of tax law experience, the law office of Beverly Winstead has successfully negotiated settlements, reduced payments, and won disputes against the IRS for its clients. Go to www.irshelpattorneys.com for tax resolution for you or your business, or call 301-306-1234. The Law Office of Beverly Winstead, you're not alone. Call 301-306-1234.
Are you a business owner and your business needs a boost? Are you ready to build or grow a profitable business that delivers new clients and customers to you every month? Have your business highlighted on a national radio show or TV network. Let MortonMediaTV.com help you get the maximum exposure your business deserves so that you can get the customers you need. MortonMediaTV.com will help you start or grow your business rapidly through the power of TV and radio. You can reach hundreds of thousands of viewers and listeners who want to buy your product or service. At MortonMediaTV.com, our mission is to teach business owners how to use the media to their benefit. You can become a thriving entrepreneur and achieve the financial freedom you've always dreamed about. Go to MortonMediaTV.com and get your business on TV or radio for the maximum exposure you deserve and the customers you need. That's MortonMediaTV.com.
Hey, Small Business Report listeners, this is your host, Carl Brown and Sharon Morton. Are you a growing small or mid-sized government contractor ready to reduce your back office costs? Do you want to maximize your compliance and minimize risk managing contracts? Move your business to the next level of success with At Work Systems.
At Work's OneLink solution provides electronic self-services to every employee, greatly reducing frustrating paperwork. Your managers get out-of-the-box processes that increases productivity, improves control, and eliminates surprises. And most importantly, your executives get the real-time data and analysis needed to make better decisions.
Take it from us here on the Small Business Report on SiriusXM. Let At Work Systems streamline your back office and save you money while doing it.
Visit ExploreAtWork.com now and receive your free demo and business assessment. That's ExploreAtWork.com.
This is HUR Voices on SiriusXM Radio Channel 141 with your hosts Carl Brown and Sharon Wood.
Welcome back to the Small Business Report here on SiriusXM. We got Pam Perry in the house. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, I'm excited about what she has to say. She is the publisher of Speakers Magazine and the co-founder of Digital Business Acceleration.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I like
hey,
that.
Pam, how you doing?
Hey, Pam. I'm thanks for joining us.
Great. Thank you, Sharon. Thank you, Carol. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, we're excited. We love to have small businesses on the show that can tell our small business owners, you know, how to take their business to the next level. And I know that's part of what you do for Digital Business Acceleration and how they can get contracts, major media and publishing contracts. So, what were you going to say, Carl?
I'm sorry. No, I was just going to ask, how do you create a brand that identifies you as an expert in your niche?
Yeah. Because a lot of people... Go ahead, Pam. I'm sorry.
That is the million-dollar question. But content is king. So you really have to just show off that you're an expert. One of the quickest ways, well, not really quick, but one of the quickest ways, which Ron knows this, to talk about it, is to publish a book that shows you're an authority. You're an author. The word authority has the word author in it. So author a book on your subject to show that you are an expert and that expertise builds your brand, builds your platform.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you said not that's not such a quick way, but it is the one of the best ways to show off your expertise. Why do you say it's not so quick? Nothing well, in businesses, as a matter of fact.
Exactly. I mean, you could actually probably type it all out. But mm-hmm. if you're someone that is more audio driven, and most of the speakers are, they probably have a lot of podcasts or a lot of interviews or maybe a lot of even speeches that they have written, PowerPoints, and they can convert that content into a book, a consumable book with maybe 12 chapters, 148 pages, and they're good to go. They can use their mm-hmm. book like their big business card.
Mm. So you say 148 pages. I'm like, that's a lot of book.
I don't think that's much at all, Carl. Yeah. You think that's a lot?
That's a good start. That's a good start.
Because I'm looking at like, you know, 40, 50 pages, bang, bang. You know? Now, if I, you know, doing 2, 3, 4 different volumes, that's cool too. You know, but
well, some people do when they start out. If you're an expert in something, some people start out doing tips booklets. And so mm-hmm. tips booklets are basically like little bite-sized nuggets, like 52 tips of such and such. And they are just little bite-sized nuggets. And that's something that they have. They can put in an envelope and mail out or sell in the back of the room. But it's a good start there. But they build from that into an actual book where then they can get into major media, you know, radio, TV, and print, that kind of thing. But a book really does set you apart, so to speak.
Yeah.
Now, these like self-published or like,
yes.
you know, you get a deal with somebody.
Well, once you self-publish and they say once you put your own skin in the game, your own money where your mouth is, and you sell, say, 5 or 10,000 copies of that self-published book, you could then go on and get a publishing deal. But what a lot of my authors have found is that they make more money when they self-publish than when they get that publishing deal. And the publishing deals usually take somewhere between 18 to 2 years for it to really go through a cycle and get published, where you could self-publish a book, have it done, and really get it finished in 90 days.
Yeah, that's a lot of time that you save, and sounds like money as well.
Yes, exactly.
With all this print on demand and all that, you're not even wasting money with a lot of inventory, because you know before it used to be, oh, you got to have a minimum of 1,000 books, so you print 1,000 books and it might take 6-7 months to sell mm-hmm. all that, and then mm-hmm. your money's just tied up in your inventory.
Your inventory sitting out in the garage,
right? It's two different. Like I said, sometimes you could use a book as a big business card. So a lot of authors and speakers will give away the book as lead generators. Okay. So they know that's the intention of it. And so mm-hmm. they'll have that book and they'll actually give that book away. So it is print on demand and they could do 500 copies or so. But if those 500 copies generate into clients or they get speaking gigs from that, it will pay for itself.
Yeah, that's true. How do you help your clients build a platform that will sustain their speaking and publishing career? Like, you know, part of it is like the book. Is there any other thing that they can do that will sustain their careers? Do they keep writing more books? Do they, what happens?
Well, being a publicist, I said, okay, let's do a calendar for 12 months and you have me on retainer and we can talk about what every single month, where we can have you somewhere in the media. And that involves pitching you and writing press releases and finding hooks. So outside the fact of they're doing what they're doing day to day, but they have to really understand the news cycle, how they can be a part of the news. Maybe they'll be a regular on the show. There's different things that they can do. But I always say social media, obviously, that's one thing that they can do from their phone. But when you want to get into a larger, I guess,
market
positioning, mm-hmm. you want to go into media.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And how do you help your client? Oh, go ahead. What were you going to say?
Yeah. So say, for instance, that they enter themselves into a competition, they win an award. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's a mm-hmm. news item. That's something that's a press release. If they are launching something, a new product, that's a press release. So we look at their whole business model and say, what is it that you have coming up for the next 12 months? How can we really you know, piggyback off of some kind of news that's going on in your city or in your state or even nationwide. A lot of it is podcasting too. I tell them that they can get on podcasts if they can't get on, you know, terrestrial radio. That's a good way too, because they can niche down. So I really look at their overall strategy mm-hmm. of what it is that they're trying to do first and foremost. Yeah. And knowing that they're leading with the content, leading with their book, leading with the blog, they're doing social. But then I always say, do not forget the traditional media, newspapers, magazines, television, and radio.
Yeah, a lot of people do forget that. Everybody mm-hmm. focuses on social media, but there's so much more.
There is. It is. And media is not going away.
No, it's not. Local newspapers all over. When yes. I go to different cities, I always look for the local newspaper, and I'll send them. Sometimes I would write an article and send it in just because they're always looking for content.
Right, they are.
That is really key. And especially our Black press. The Black press will exactly. always be there for us. That's one of the reasons why they exist. They're always there for us. So I tell them, I said, if you have a really strong opinion, write an opinion editorial and send that in to the Black press. You know, the Black yeah. News, USA, or different vehicles where you can be seen as an expert. That's really building your platform. I said, don't go with the herd, you know, stay off of Instagram so much and Facebook. I mean, everybody can post anything anywhere there. But when you're vetted through the media, it
gives you really credibility.
Yes. Mm-hmm. It really yeah. does. It's vetted okay. by people who have journalism ethics. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right. And long-time careers.
Exactly. I love the media. I mean, my background is in journalism. So that's one of the things that I always is my go-to for a lot of the business owners. That says, do not discount the fact that just because there's social media that you don't have to be in, quote unquote, traditional media. They go hand in hand.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You
want to be in everything.
Everything, yeah, that's right.
There is a thing of overexposure, but you want to be out there as, especially if you like with us, talking about small business issues. And that's what I, you know, write about all the time is when I'm, you know, like the Caribbean newspapers and all that, because mm-hmm. that community has, they have a work ethic of, they want to have their own small businesses. They're not looking to get a job in the government and all that. They're looking to build and start their own business. So I'm always saying, well, hey, this is part of my audience right here.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're
and
right,
there's
Carl.
Loyalty, too. When you're in the Caribbean News Network, there is loyalty built in there, and they support each other. And as African-Americans, Blacks, that we should support each other, too. So that goes along with supporting the press, supporting the business. And I said, it's a whole mindset shift of really understanding that, because our culture should do that more because other cultures do that.
That's right. They do that more. Yeah. Mm-hmm. My background is journalism as well. And I always, you know, join or renew my membership with the National Association of Black Journalists. And it's also a great, it's an organization that's been around for decades, and they do a lot to support and celebrate, you know, other, you know, Black news organizations, small outlets, big outlets, you know, and sometimes even mm-hmm. small businesses. So we've got about mm-hmm. 30 seconds. So we're going to come back on the other side of the break, Pam, and talk about who can people depend on to buy their book? Like, who's the audience? And, you know, how you already talked about developing a campaign strategy, but we also want to talk about how can people actually generate media contacts for their clients. So we'll be right back after these messages on the Small Business Report on SiriusXM Radio Channel 141. Hey, Small Business Report listeners. We've said goodbye to summer, and it's time for things to get back to our everyday autumn groove. With so much changing around us, it's difficult to find that extra time for you. With Plexaderm, all you need is 10 minutes and you can look 10 years younger. Plexaderm is a clinically studied serum that gives your appearance the right kind of changes. Visibly reduce wrinkles, fine lines, and even under eye bags in minutes. Take up to 10 years off your appearance in less than 10 minutes. The results will last for hours. Try a 6-application trial pack for just $14.95 with free shipping when you visit
try Plexaderm.com or call 800-685-1292 and use the code SMALL. This order comes with free shipping and a 30-day money-back guarantee. Make those wrinkles, lines, and under-eye bags disappear with Plexaderm. Visit TryPlexaderm.com or call 800-685-1292 and say the code SMALL at checkout.
Get ready for skincare and makeup that will heal your mind, body, and soul. SkinDeepBeautyStore.com is a totally organic and vegan skincare and makeup line that you'll love using, because what you put on your body is just as important as what you put in it. Choose from our organic moisturizers, anti-aging serums, natural and fruit-based scrubs, masks, lipsticks, and glosses. No more worries about harsh chemicals being absorbed into your skin. It's time to commit to your health and wellness. SkinDeepBeautyStore.com is your one-stop, cruelty-free skincare and makeup shop with safe and environmentally friendly ingredients for the love of you. Visit us at SkinDeepBeautyStore.com. That's SkinDeepBeautyStore.com.
Do you need expert advice from successful business leaders on how to start, grow, and finance your business? Tune in every week to the Small Business Report at HUR Voices on Sirius XM Channel 141 with your hosts, Carl Brown and Sharon Morton. The Small Business Report gives you, the small business owner, and those thinking about starting a business, expert advice from successful business leaders around the country. Visit us at smallbusinessreport.biz and like us on Facebook. The Small Business Report, giving you the tools you need to succeed.
This is HUR Voices on Sirius XM Radio Channel 141 with your hosts, Carl Brown and Sharon Wood.
You're listening to the Small Business Report here on Sirius XM with Carl Brown and Sharon Morton. We got Pam Perry, an award-winning communications professional, talking about how you can build your brand and how you can get out there as a speaker and an author. And Pam, before we go any further, please give the audience your website and how to get in contact with you.
Oh, sure. No problem. They can go to PamPerryPR.com. That's where they'll find everything. The podcast is there. The magazine is there. And of course, obviously the blog is there. But PamPerryPR.com.
Okay.
Wonderful.
Yeah, that's great. And you know what, Pam, you were talking before the break about, you know, building a platform and publishing a book and, you know, content is king. Tell us what people can do if they do decide to build, write a book. How can they define and target their audience? Like, you know, decide, okay, who's going to buy this book? And that's who I'm going to target.
A lot of the authors are speakers, or speakers are authors, and they go hand in hand. So when you are speaking on a platform, look at who is in that audience, right? Like, who are the people that are really the people that respond to your message? The people that respond to your message, you can physically see. Well, we used to before COVID. We could physically see who are the people that were responding. And you can really get a clue from that. But I always say, go to Amazon. Amazon is the best research tool that you can do, because when you go on Amazon, you maybe look at the top 10 books in your genre and you say, okay, I speak on, say for me, public relations. I speak on public relations and branding. So who are the top 10 leaders in that space? Mm-hmm. And then you look at them and see how maybe their audience, they do cover that topic, but who do they speak to? And you can really tell by looking at their reviews who it is that is reviewing their books, and then what they say they love about the book, or what they say maybe the book lacks. You start with Amazon. So for me, I would look at maybe, say, someone like David Meerman Scott. He wrote a book called PR 2.0. Well, he really talks to corporations. He doesn't really talk to authors and speakers about building a platform. So then maybe I'll look at another book and say, okay, they do speak to authors and speakers, but they speak to maybe a primarily Caucasian audience. Okay, well, they speak to... So you look in Amazon, because it has everything in it that you would see. You can look at the author's website and see how they're different and how you're different from them. Not to copy them, but to see what is your unique advantage over what they're doing. And I always say, go with that first. and go with Amazon.
Mm-hmm. That's good. That's a good tip.
So what gets noticed by the media in a press kit or marketing materials?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the tools are really important. Once we actually have the strategy and we know what we're doing and where we're going with everything, you got to have the different tools. And one of the tools that I say, if you have a book, you need something very similar to what a movie would have. You need a book trailer. Just like there's a movie trailer, you'll have a book trailer. People buy the book based on their cover. Even though, contrary to belief, people don't judge a book by their cover. Yes, they do. Yes,
yeah, they do. We know that's for real.
They judge a book by the cover. They really do. They spend about 3 seconds on the front and 5 seconds on the back. So you got a total of 8 seconds to figure out if this person's going to buy this book. So you have a book trailer. And so that really is what you would use on YouTube and use in social media, really to explain the book. And the other thing that people really need, besides the EPK, electronic press kit, is just really a speaking reel. So if you're a speaker, you just need a speaking reel so that people can sample what it is that you speak on. Mm-hmm. You can have it, a voiceover with some pictures, or you can have some speaking clips or maybe some media view. But it needs to be a sizzle reel, a sample reel of what it is that you're speaking on. And those are like one of the two main things. Besides the press kit, obviously you need the branding photos. Please, you need the photos. You need the branding photos, but professional photos. Because a lot of times when I'm working with clients in the newspaper, the magazine says, yeah, this is great. We love it. We'll run it. Send us some professional photos. They have to have professional photos, especially if they said, well, we'd love to put them on the cover. And if we don't have a professional photo, it's like, you missed that opportunity, buddy. So we do need to do, I know a lot of business owners and speakers are like, oh my goodness, I've got to do a photo shoot. Yeah, well, you could do one every 5 years. You don't have to do them every week, but at least every 5 years, do a batch. And that would suffice.
Yeah. And use photos that, like you said, are recent, so that when you walk in to speak, they aren't expecting the 1995 person. And here it is, 2021. You want to be recognizable.
Well, you know, politicians are known for that.
Yeah, I know.
We'll have vertical as well as horizontal photos, because you never know what the publication will need. People are so used to really doing the vertical photos, but you also need horizontal as well, because when they're putting it in like their posts, a lot of them are horizontal pictures. So you want to make sure. And in my, I really show people how to tell their photographer what they need. So I do a photo shoot planner and I give to them in my program so that people will know what they're, spend all that time and money with the photographer.
Yeah.
Give them a plan so that you know what it is that you're looking for.
Right. I like that, that you do that. So how do you generate media contacts for your clients? I mean, you send out, their books, their book trailer. What do you do?
Yeah. So a lot of it, like you said, is relationships. I'm a member of NABJ as well, National Association of Black Journalists. So I've been in it for years, ever since college. And so a lot of the people who I went to college with, they're now like executives and major media outlets. But a lot of it is relationships and knowing who covers what. And so knowing who covers what, you match your client to the media. And that's really it. And then you're being an assistant to the media. Like, this is someone that I think you should have on your show or have in your publication because I know you cover this. So really, the main thing is really having media relations and having with the people cover and really making that pitch. And it's really, I call it a wash, rinse, and repeat.
Wash, rinse, and repeat. And, Carl and I talk about that all the time. Relationships, networking, knowing people. People do business with people that they know, that they like, and that they trust. Yes. That's in any industry.
Well, trust is a big one.
Yeah.
That's a big one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because they trust you to bring them somebody credible.
That's right. Yeah.
And that's why a lot of people use publicists, really, because they do, the journalist has worked with the publicist and they know the publicist is going to work with someone that has been vetted by them so that they won't look bad on their end that, you have a guest that can't speak or you have a guest that was a totally fraud. I mean, so you really want to work with a publicist because they know that they are going to get the response from the media because they have served up really good clients for them.
So we only have about 3 minutes, Pam, but tell us about your digital business acceleration company. What is that?
That is actually a podcast because this was even before COVID. we did a podcast because we find we could do all this marketing and branding and PR for you, but people didn't have the foundational things correct. So they didn't know what was exactly needed on a website. They didn't know how to really put together automated systems. They didn't know a lot about social media. So Digital Business Acceleration is 52 episodes on digitalbusinessacceleration.com where they can hear the exact training that they need in order to accelerate their business online. Now, this was pre-COVID. We started it in October last year and it went for 52 weeks. We had no idea that at the beginning of 2020 that everything would be shut down and most businesses at that point became online. So really, we wanted, especially African Americans, to really understand the proper way to do things online, whether your website is a WordPress or a Wix or a Weebly. We still wanted you to have certain systems in place, a calendar link. You need, if you're going to do a podcast, the best way to do a podcast, how to make everything integrate. It sounds technical, but we broke it down so that it's real talk, like really the easy way to
layman's terms, yeah.
Layman terms.
Yeah, but it's important. It's really important because if I go to a website and all of the material on there is dated, I'm going to keep moving.
That's right, Carl. Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like the person died and it's like, okay, well, I guess I got a lot more.
And your website really is like your billboard too. I mean, it's a digital billboard.
It's your hub to everything that you're going to do online, because the main thing that we teach in Digital Business Acceleration is to build your own real estate online. It's good to have the social media, but you need to have your own real estate. When I say that, you own everything. You own your podcast. It streams through your own website. Your website is owned by you. That everything. So say if any of these social media sites go down or they close your account, you have an email list that you have access to that you've built, because these are people that you talk to on a regular basis. So we show people how to really own that in terms of making sure that they are getting the that they're building their platform, their own platform, not building Facebook platform, but their own platform.
Well, Pam, it has been wonderful having you on the show. Give everybody your website address again so that they can reach out to you.
Yes, PamPerryPR.com. What they'll find there is kind of like what Carl asked about. What are some of the things that they need in order to be in media? They can get a free download of a video on the 7 things that the media looks for, and I explain what each one of those things are. So they can go to PamPerryPR.com and receive that.
Okay, that's great.
Wow, thank you.
Well, thank you. Yeah, this has been great. Great information, Pam. Thank you so much for being here on the Small Business Report. And folks, please don't touch that dial. We have a great guest coming up on the other half of the show here on the Small Business Report on SiriusXM Radio Channel 141 HUR Voices.
Hey, Small Business Report listeners. Are you a small or mid-sized business? Let BDPAtoday.com help you leverage emerging technologies and digital innovations to transform your business.
BDPAtoday.com will highlight your organization's innovations, solutions, and success stories. Let BDPAtoday.com publish your branded videos, blogs, and photos to a national tech industry audience and assist with your awareness building campaign. With BDPAtoday.com, you can network with qualified and certified tech professionals and get access to developers, gamers, hackers, and interns to join your team for short or long-term projects.
Visit BDPAtoday.com for true digital transformation that will drive competitive advantage to your organization.
That's BDPAtoday.com.
Tune in to The Skin Deep Show with host Sharon Morton as she engages your senses and examines the issues affecting Black skin and its treatment in every facet of life, from beauty, health, and wellness to social injustice and mass incarceration. It's a show designed to stimulate your mind, body, and soul. Don't miss it. The Skin Deep Show, every Friday at 5:30 p.m. and Sunday at 4:30 p.m. on SiriusXM Channel 141 HUR Voices.
Are you in trouble with the IRS? Whether you owe federal or state taxes, are under audit, or need to dispute your case in tax court, don't go up against the IRS alone. Let the tax experts at the law office of Beverly Winstead fight for you. With more than 15 years of tax law experience, the law office of Beverly Winstead has successfully negotiated settlements, reduced payments, and won disputes against the IRS for its clients. Go to www.irshelpattorneys.com for tax resolution for you or your business, or call 301-306-1234. The Law Office of Beverly Winstead. You're not alone. Call 301-306-1234.
This is HRR Voices on Sirius XM Radio Channel 141 with your hosts, Carl Brown and Sharon Moore.
Welcome back to the Small Business Report here on Sirius XM Channel 141. And as we promised at the top of the hour, we're going to have urban anthropologist, D.C. native, Sabia Prince. And joining her is Mr. Jason Richardson. He is the Director of Research at the National Community Reinvestment Coalition. And they're going to be talking about the big G word, gentrification, and the effects of COVID on Black-owned businesses in the District of Columbia. But yes, it could be anywhere in this country.
That's
Minnesota,
right.
Miami, it doesn't matter. Houston, Harlem, it doesn't matter. It's all over. So,
and yeah, and she's Dr. Sabia Prince. Dr. So we want everybody to know that, yeah, that she's an urban anthropologist. And she comes with a whole lot of experience, research, and credibility. So welcome to the show, Dr. Prince and Jason.
Thank you so much. Thank you both.
So, like Carl was saying, you all are going to be talking about gentrification and displacement. You're also going to be talking about the study that you were working with the National Community Reinvestment Coalition, NCRC, and their team of geographers to actually document the impacts of COVID virus on Black-owned businesses. So tell us, where do you want to start? Because there's so much information, so much good information we want our listeners to hear.
Well, I think I should hand it over to Dr. Jason Richardson.
Oh, is it Dr. Richardson? I apologize. I didn't know you were a doctor as well. So we got two doctors on the show.
No, I'm not. I'm not a PhD. Only Sabia is the PhD, which is why we like working with her quite a bit.
Oh, my bad.
We've done work for the past few years on gentrification and displacement, which usually goes hand in hand with gentrification. It's part of the process. And we've worked with Sabia a couple of times over the past few years. So if you go to our website at ncrc.org, you can look at some of the work we've done already on gentrification. And there was a heavy focus in some of that on Washington, D.C., because of the high level of gentrification that we observed in the city. But as part of that work, we were always thinking about businesses and business gentrification. And then the chance came along for us to look at the concept of culturally significant businesses. So think about things like the go-go music in Shaw neighborhood, mm-hmm. other businesses which are culturally significant to a specific community. So when something happens to them, when they close their doors, it's a bigger blow to the community maybe than some other businesses. So it was an interesting question because there's not a great definition of culturally significant business. And so we decided to work with Sabia again, and she brought some interesting ideas about how to talk to Black business owners and focus in this case on culturally significant businesses in Black communities in Washington, D.C. and in Baltimore. Mm-hmm. So she's in the midst of that work now, and I think she could probably pick it up from here and describe a little bit about what she's doing.
And before you do, Dr. Prince, I was born and raised in Washington, D.C., and I don't recognize my city anymore. When I go into the city, it's not the city I was born and raised in. And I remember, too, before COVID, I think in 2019, there is or was a store on the corner of Florida and Georgia, I believe, that was playing go-go music during the day. And white folks started complaining about it and wanted to get rid of it. And luckily there was a whole movement, and they failed in their attempt to do that. But I'm so glad that you're bringing this information to the forefront, because I don't think there's enough discussion around it, you know, publicly anyway.
Indeed. And thank you so much for giving us an opportunity to talk about it. And I do want to preface my comments by saying that business owner is Don Campbell. Mm-hmm. And that's Central Communication, Metro PCS.
Yes, Metro PCS, that's right.
And mm-hmm. you may want to talk with him, because he is still very vulnerable right now. I spoke with a close ally of his, and he's really facing some challenges staying in place and looking, I think, for some help and some more attention. And so maybe that's something we could look into. But indeed, I mean, we recognize that a lot of these businesses are so significant. They've been in these communities for a very long time. They have a lot of tangible benefits for people. They some of them offer gathering places for folks to come and kind of celebrate community, celebrate belonging, celebrate traditions. They offer resources. Some of the entrepreneurs we've spoken with have very close ties to their communities, and they offer a whole lot of support. And when you see these businesses begin to disappear, it has a number of different impacts. I mean, there's the whole symbolic piece, as I've described, that just kind of fosters some alienation and all. But we're also talking about resources. So some of these businesses offer very important resources to their community. And when they disappear, it's a hardship on communities in a number of different ways, you know, mm-hmm. specifically hitting them in their pocketbooks, of course.
Mm-hmm. And jobs disappear too.
Yes.
Jobs disappear, and you can't find the products that you were looking for.
That's right.
Exactly. You'll have to go to a longer distance, perhaps, or find some other way, or maybe even do without. Either way, it's a negative impact. It's hurting you in the pocketbook.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I just wanted to say also there is an you know, when we started this project, the idea of cultural significance in defining that term was a challenge. And what I found was that everybody we spoke to initially, when you talked about culturally significant businesses in Black communities, you know, certain stereotypes come into play. Barbershops, or everybody mm-hmm. mentioned barbershops, mm-hmm. and a couple of other businesses. And we approached it and thought, you know, I think that's a very narrow description of what culturally significant can mean. So I think Sabia has done a really good job at locating businesses that you know, maybe not stereotypically associated with cultural significance in the Black community, but they are significant. And that, you know, that, you know, we're talking about professionals, we're talking about different types of retail establishments, that their significance is defined not necessarily by essentially the services they provide, but about their position in the community, their longevity in the community. And I think that's some of the most interesting parts of the project that we're working on now.
Yeah.
I mean, we just had a longtime hairdresser that was on Georgia Avenue, but, you know, she had closed business and retired some years ago that has passed away. But she had a very significant impact on the community, the Georgia Avenue corridor, while she was alive and had the beauty salon up and running.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, yeah. You know what I'm confused about is in a lot of these major cities, you have Black governments, Black mayors, Black city councils, and they seem to just be letting this happen. You know, I'm not gonna name any names because, you know, Carl and I have always said this is not a political show, but that's what really concerns me. What I will name a name of Mayor Marion Barry, who fought against gentrification, but it seems that these Black mayors are allowing this to happen, and I'm not certain if it's just a money game. What's going on? Why are they allowing all of this displacement? Not just businesses, but, you know, people, Black folks can't even afford to move into the district anymore. It's too expensive.
Yes. Well, I think you raise a real important point, and I'll say that this project is not a political project, so I want to be clear about that. You know, we're just looking at these data, but I'll just speak as Sabia, the independent person not involved in this project necessarily, and just kind of reinforce that gentrification is a policy-driven thing that we're confronting mm-hmm. in this moment. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not something that's natural or primordial or any thing like that. It's driven by policies of neglect, and it's driven by policies of corporate welfare. So, you know, I don't know what to say about that other than I think it's incumbent upon all of us to hold our elected officials accountable, to be very aware of where they get their donations and what sort of policies they're passing or introducing and what kind of meetings they're taking and who they're listening to, and make sure that everyone's voices are heard and kind of really push for development that's very community-based, since a lot of resources are going into what we're seeing transforming our cities right now.
Yeah, community-based and affordable. You know, they should not be making a city that's only affordable for the rich. The these laws and plans that were done 20 years ago, 10 years ago, they don't seem to be including people who cannot afford $1 million condominiums on the waterfront. But anyway, we have to get ready to go to break, and we will be right back after these messages. Please stay tuned here on the Small Business Report on SiriusXM Radio Channel 141, HUR Voices.
Hey, Small Business Report listeners. We've said goodbye to summer, and it's time for things to get back to our everyday autumn groove. With so much changing around us, it's difficult to find that extra time for you. With Plexaderm, all you need is 10 minutes and you can look 10 years younger. Plexaderm is a clinically studied serum that gives your appearance the right kind of changes. Visibly reduce wrinkles, fine lines, and even under eye bags in minutes. Take up to 10 years off your appearance in less than 10 minutes. The results will last for hours. Try a 6-application trial pack for just $14.95 with free shipping when you visit triplexaderm.com or call 800-685-1292 and use the code SMALL. This order comes with free shipping and a 30-day money-back guarantee. Make those wrinkles, lines, and under-eye bags disappear with Plexaderm. Visit triplexaderm.com or call 800-685-1292 and say the code SMALL at checkout.
Hey, Small Business Report listeners, this is your host, Carl Brown and Sharon Martin. Are you a growing small or mid-sized government contractor ready to reduce your back office costs? Do you want to maximize your compliance and minimize risks managing contracts? Move your business to the next level of success with At-Work Systems.
At-Work's OneLink solution provides electronic self-services to every employee, greatly reducing frustrating paperwork. Your managers get out-of-the-box processes that increases productivity, improves control, and eliminates surprises. And most importantly, your executives get the real-time data and analysis needed to make better decisions.
Take it from us here on the Small Business Report on SiriusXM. Let At-Work Systems streamline your back office and save you money while doing it.
Visit exploreatwork.com now and receive your free demo and business assessment. That's exploreatwork.com. Are you a business owner and your business needs a boost? Are you ready to build or grow a profitable business that delivers new clients and customers to you every month? Have your business highlighted on a national radio show or TV network. Let MortonMediaTV.com help you get the maximum exposure your business deserves so that you can get the customers you need. MortonMediaTV.com will help you start or grow your business rapidly through the power of TV and radio. You can reach hundreds of thousands of viewers and listeners who want to buy your product or service. At MortonMediaTV.com, our mission is to teach business owners how to use the media to their benefit. You can become a thriving entrepreneur and achieve the financial freedom you've always dreamed about. Go to MortonMediaTV.com and get your business on TV or radio for the maximum exposure you deserve and the customers you need. That's MortonMediaTV.com.
This is HUR Voices on SiriusXM Radio Channel 141 with your hosts, Carl Brown and Sharon Morton.
Welcome back to the Small Business Report here on SiriusXM Channel 141. And we are fortunate enough to have Dr. Sabia Prince and Mr. Jason Richardson from the NCRC. And I just want to jump right in because we need to get this information out there. What has been some of the common issues that Black businesses are experiencing during this pandemic?
Well, I think thank you for that question. And it really is going to depend on what kind of business they have, right? We have a number of different businesses that we've interacted with. And some of them, for example, are food providers. And they're going to have a huge challenge because they can no longer have folks inside, at least at a key part when the pandemic first hit. So they were scrambling to think of what they could do. We have some folks that are booksellers, and we have a gift shop that was very small, and they didn't have a lot of traffic, so she didn't have to adjust terribly dramatically. And then we also have a few folks that have virtual businesses. So for them, you know, it was just like water off a duck's back because that's what they're doing anyway. But generally, it's the same issues that we're all confronting right now, and that is, how do you engage in your business while engaging in social distancing and making sure that you're safe and that your customers and that your staff are going to be safe. So that comes with a lot of challenges. And we found some folks, of course, that were closed initially and have been able to reopen. So, you know, there's lots of different things that folks are grappling with right now around the pandemic.
Yeah, and I'll just say, you know, we're focused as an organization on the fair and equal access to credit, and businesses all over are struggling with getting credit for expanding operations or keeping their operations. And the, you know, many of them are also struggling with the Paycheck Protection Program or the EIDL program that provides emergency cash to businesses. So, and we're hearing from a lot of Black businesses in this and other studies that there's some distrust of those programs, for one thing. There's distrust that the loans will be forgiven like they're supposed to be. And it's difficult if you don't have a banking relationship sometimes with a bank already to access those funds. So that's another challenge that we're hearing about from all businesses, but specifically from Black businesses as well.
We talk a lot about that, don't we, Carl, on the show, having relationships with your bankers.
Yeah.
Do most of the businesses that you interviewed have plans for post-COVID? You know, what are they going to do after the pandemic is finally over?
Well, what I'm seeing is that businesses are pivoting, those that are able to do so. And perhaps these are practices that are going to carry forward after the pandemic. Mm-hmm. But I'm seeing a number of different things, people being a little more aggressive about their websites. Talking, you know, discussing with us that prior to this, they weren't paying as much attention to it. So they're now investing more time, more resources, and also distributing more goods that way. You have new partnerships that we're observing are forming. Businesses are thinking outside of the box and partnering with school systems and partnering with advocacy groups and other nonprofits to get their business out there. So these are some of the things that we're observing. There's one person who's actually expanded during this time. Yeah, there's a gentleman in Baltimore who has a very unique business. He's an agricultural educator named Dominic Nell, and he had after school programs where he's teaching children how to start their own businesses and how to do urban farming. And now he's doing Zooms in Ghana with children over there. And he's teaching at a high school in Baltimore, and he's doing food rescues and gathering hundreds of thousands of pounds of rescued food to share with his community. So this gentleman is actually busier now than he was before the pandemic.
Yeah, I have a friend. She's a psychologist or psychiatrist, excuse me. And unfortunately, her business is booming during the pandemic because so many people, you know, are having mental challenges from being, you know, having to be stuck in the house and not communicate or see family and friends on a regular basis. So she said she can't even take any more new customers or clients. And then I know someone else that has a mobile dog grooming service. And so they can't take any more clients or customers because they've just, the business has just exploded. So.
Oh, wow. That's interesting. Well, we also talked with a owner of a funeral service in Baltimore, and he talked about the impact. I mean, of course, you know, there is more death, but at the same time, he's talking about people are not doing the traditional funerals any longer. They can't gather in the same way. So you're going to see more cremations, and you're going to see more graveside funerals as well.
And definitely watching funerals and weddings via Zoom, which I don't like, but what do you do, you know?
Right.
That's right. Yeah. So what do you see as far as the future of Black businesses in the geographic areas you have studied?
Well, I'll say this. If you want to judge it by the patterns and where we are now, in all of these areas, you're seeing a decrease in the number of businesses. So we have a few folks, for example, the funeral service, they go back to the 1970s. We spoke with the owner of Lee Flower Shop. That goes back to 1945. Mm-hmm. Zawadi, they're just celebrating their 30th anniversary. And when you talk with these folks, particularly those on U Street, they talk about what it used to be, that there were more businesses and that there was a tighter community. So they're, you know, they have a story of loss. And, you know, I don't have a crystal ball, but I think if there's not more aggressive ways of addressing this, you're going to see a decrease in the amount of businesses, as well as perhaps new kind of businesses opening up, because you also have a number of smoke shops that have opened up on U Street.
Yeah, I've seen those. What can we do to address it, though? Like, I mean, reach out to our elected officials. I mean, what can we do? It seems like it's almost, I don't know how we can reverse what's going on.
Well, I mean, part of it, you know, there's always a natural ebb and flow to small businesses. And, you know, in times of recession, you see businesses close and open. You know, this report, we're looking specifically at a class of business that we consider to be culturally significant. And it's possible that, I mean, you know, if we have a definition, if we can look at a community and say, okay, there's a lot of businesses here, but here's a handful that really are significant in the way that we define this neighborhood. You know, this neighborhood just isn't the same without these businesses. Then, you know, that opens the door for other policy solutions. Local communities can you know, look at ways to protect those businesses in some way. And, you know, that's kind of what I hope will be the outcome of this project, you know, just by providing a definition and a method where you can identify businesses that are culturally important. Mm-hmm. Then that opens the door to activism and advocacy and policy solutions that are targeted at protecting those businesses for the, you know, for the impact they have on the rest of the community.
Yeah. What did you say your website address was again? Because we only have about 2 minutes.
ncrc.org. So that's N like national, ncrc.org. And if anybody has any questions, they can, you know, find my contact information on there. I'd be happy to answer any more questions about this study or the work we've done on gentrification and displacement.
And that's the National Community Reinvestment Coalition.
That's correct. Yes.
And do great work.
Yeah. And is that how we can reach out to you as well, Dr. Prince?
I can be reached. Yes, you can do that as well, but I have a website, www.sabiaprince.com, and I can be reached via email, which is Sabia, spelled S as in Sam, A, B as in boy, I, Y, H, A, dot Robin, R-O-B-I-N, @gmail.com.
Okay. Well, this has been eye-opening. Great information, right, Carl?
Absolutely. Thank you for being on the show and providing all of this good information. I mean, it doesn't matter if you're in Washington, D.C., Baltimore, Brooklyn. It's all over the country, and we got to come up with better strategies on how to keep these businesses in the community to serve the people in the community and provide the jobs in the community.
That's right. Yeah. So, yeah, if you want to get more information about this show and any other show, you can go to thesmallbusinessreport.biz. You can always listen to the show on SiriusXM Radio Channel 141 HUR Voices. So that's it for now. I'm Carl.
We'll be back next week with vital information to help you grow your business.
This has been Carl Brown and Sharon Morton giving you all the tools you need to succeed on the Small Business Report.
Thank you for listening, and be sure to tune in next week at HUR Voices on Sirius XM channel 141. Please don't forget to like us on Facebook. And for more tips on starting, growing, and financing your business, visit us at thesmallbusinessreport.biz.